Welcome back, AP. Welcome back to it. Welcome back to your flipped classroom and starting a completely new topic, right? So we are now going to be moving into something a little bit different, right? And some of y'all are probably like, why is European history like this, right? And I like totally understand and get that. But if you had to deal with the College Board the way that I had to deal with them, you'd be asking a lot more questions, right? Like, why do you set it up this way? Why is it pitched in this way? But you know what? We got to play their game a little bit, right? We have to play their game, and we're now going to be picking up what's going to go down in Europe after Napoleon is exiled that second time, right? So we talked a lot in that last flip about a lot of different stuff, but what I need you to focus on for all y'all that are thinking about how hard this is going to be to study, just remember, start big picture, then go small, right? Know the general Napoleon timeline. And actually, what I'm going to do for y'all as well is I'm going to post that last Prezi and stuff like that and kind of tell you where along the lines to start whenever you're actually looking through and actually going and studying it. So you got to understand, start big picture, then go small, right? We talked about how Napoleon rose into power, took over 85% of Europe using mostly a land army, and then he's going to fall because of three big mistakes. Understand those three big mistakes. What was the continental system? What's the Peninsular War? What's the invasion of Russia? Don't worry about the nitty-gritty details of everything until later, right? You need to focus more along the lines of, like, invasion of Russia, why'd he do it, why'd it fail, and then he ends up exiled, right? Why did he, or he comes back for 100 days, he fails at the Battle of Waterloo, he's exiled again, right? Focus on the big stuff, then go small, okay? Like, don't worry yourself so much with these teeny tiny little details, okay? But the big thing about it, though, is we are now moving into another big chapter movement kind of thing, but it's still a part of the same unit in the College Board curriculum. We're now moving into what is known as the Congress of Vienna and the period after Napoleon, right? And it all starts with this year. 1815. 1815 is a groundbreaking year in European history because it's going to dynamically symbolize a change and a shift in history in general when we're talking about the history of Europe. Because this is going to be the moment that Europe now has to pick up the pieces that was itself following the destruction by Napoleon. Because basically when you're looking at Europe, it's a lot like this. Exactly, right? Napoleon comes in. He is that hammer that shatters the European norms and stuff like that. Now you got to piece it all back together, okay? So when we're looking at this, we got to understand that why is this year so essential? This year is so essential because it is the final exiling of Napoleon, right? In 1815, following the Battle of Waterloo, the Europe is now going to have to figure out how does it prevent the spread of revolutions? How does it monitor and like kind of, what's the word I'm looking for here? Mediate the understandings of the Enlightenment. Has the Enlightenment gone too far? Is it not going far enough, right? How do you actually repair all the damage that has been done? I mean, y'all, we used to have a Holy Roman Empire, and now it's gone. What are you going to do about this, right? This year is so essential, and I love to use this imagery kind of to discuss why this is such a big deal. I call it the concept of Napoleon's toothpaste, right? Have any of y'all have ever actually seen a tube of toothpaste? You've tried to, like, if you squeeze toothpaste out of a tube of toothpaste, there's no going back in, right? You're not getting all of it back in there. Remnants of it will be left behind, right? And that's the big thing about Napoleon. He is that toothpaste. He squeezed it all out, and we're frantically going to try and put it back in. But there are going to be certain ideas that have spread, and Europe will never be the same after this, right? But the thing about it is some people are going to kind of come in along, these other larger powers, and they're going to try and bring Europe back to what it was, right? Because we have some big issues on our hands, right? One, we have the balance of power, right? What's going on? Because France tipped those scales very aggressively when Napoleon takes over like 85% of Europe, right? We got to also pick up the pieces after Napoleon because we have millions dead, right? Because after the Napoleonic Wars, you're going to have large-scale death because of war. You're also going to have 590,000 guys dead just from the invasion of Russia alone. And then you also have to figure out how to restructure because, like I said, we used to have a Holy Roman Empire, but now that Napoleon's gone and the boundaries are going to be redrawn, do we put the Holy Roman Empire back from the Confederation of the Rhine, or do we change this up a little bit, right? So we have to figure out how are we going to restructure everything, right? Are some countries going to get bigger? What do we do with Poland? Because it was gone before this whole thing started, and then what ends up happening is Napoleon brings it back, but are we going to keep it, or are we going to get rid of it, right? Fun fact, to get rid of it. So going into it, though, you have to understand that this is all going to be decided at a meeting, that you need to highlight, you need to star, you need to underline, you need to make this thing look like it's exploding. I'm not kidding. You need to circle this moment in history like 1,400 times. It's known as the Congress of Vienna, right? Now, a Congress, of course, is a meeting, like kind of a lot like the Diet of Worms is so important, or the Council of Trent is so important. There are a lot of meetings in European history that are going to be huge, right? The Congress of Vienna might be the most important one, you could argue, right? And it's going to take place from 1814 to 1815. Now, some of y'all are raising your hand already, and you're like, but Mr. Terry, what about, why is it starting in 1814 if 1815 is when Napoleon got exiled? Blah, 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 blah. Well, look, the Congress of Vienna, the meeting started after he was exiled the first time, right? When he ends up in Elba, the Congress of Vienna meets for the very first time to try and figure out the answers to all of these issues, right? So it is going to be a meeting of what is now known as the Quadruple Alliance, which is basically the four big forces within the coalition forces that Napoleon fought against, right? And who do you think these people are, right? If you were to take some wild guesses, I'm hearing a lot of you go ahead and shouting out, the Netherlands? No, it's not going to be them, right? It's going to be all the big guys that end with Ia and then one other one, okay? We're talking about Russia, Prussia, Austria, and Great Britain, right? Those are your quadruple alliance figures. Now, notice I've got Russia, Prussia, Austria together, and I got Great Britain down at the bottom. Well, because a lot of it has to do with the fact that Russia, Prussia, and Austria are still operating as basically absolute monarchies, whereas Great Britain's just like, oh, we're having an industrial revolution, tea and crumpets, and we're also making buttloads of money, and we're a little bit different, and we're off the continent. Now, so we need to understand that, like, Great Britain, a little bit different out of these four guys. They mainly just want to make sure that they keep making their money and revenues at the time because the Industrial Revolution is exploding in their country. We'll talk about that next unit, right? Love to talk about that Industrial Revolution. Whereas Russia, Prussia, and Austria are trying to figure out how do they keep their monarchy strong? How do they bring absolutism back with full force, right? So going into it, we have to understand the fifth guy is this thing known as Restoration France, right? Not to be confused with Restoration Great Britain, which is when Charles II and James II came back after the Commonwealth period. Different time. So the Restoration France stuff is going to be, what do we do with the French government after Napoleon is gone, right? So like now that's Restoration France, okay? So looking at this map, y'all, we got to figure out at this Congress of Vienna, what are you going to do? What are you going to do? How are you going to take the map from looking like this and figure out how to restructure it, right? Now, the goal in line of this entire meeting is something I need you to write down real quick. The goal of the Quadruple Alliance at this meeting was to create this thing that they referred to as the Concert of Europe, right? Like, do me a favor really quick, write that down, right? And I want you to imagine while you're writing that down, just imagine some classical music in the back of your mind, right? Some classical music, like some Waltz of the Flowers, or some, like not the Rite of Spring, that's really aggressive. Waltz of the Flowers, maybe some Wagner, right? Some really soft classical music, okay? When you hear that in your mind, that's what they're trying to get to with the Congress of Vienna, right? They want everything to feel like it's coming together to make a beautiful piece of a beautiful piece of music, right? When you look at an orchestra, you've got strings, you've got the brass, you've got woodwinds, you've got all of these different elements that combine together to make a beautiful sound, right? That's their goal. Because looking at this right here, this is more like Master of Puppets by Metallica, right? This is much more aggressive, and this is Napoleon just taking over everything, literally with like Eddie from Stranger Things just like shredding on top of that trailer, right? What they want is this. That is the Concert of Europe, right? Everybody back in their place, and the powers are all aligned to prevent the Enlightenment from causing any more revolutions, right? That right there is the Concert of Europe, okay? So the thing we need to understand, though, going into it as well, is how do you deal with France, right? What do you do? They formerly owned controlled the Confederation of the Rhine. They had occupational forces inside German lands. They took over all of northern Italy. They took over, like, created the Duchy of Warsaw, which is like Poland 2.0, right? Like, so what do you do with them, right? What do you do with them? But ironically enough, they were actually pretty lenient on them, right? They actually were pretty nice. And when they approached it, they actually decided to take pity on France in a little bit of a way. Now, of course, who do y'all think, of course, is the guy that structured this whole deal? None other than your boy, Charles Talleyrand, is the guy that goes to the to the Congress of Vienna and represents Restoration France. And he creates the following provisions. He pitches it to him and be like, look, if you want to prevent France from freaking out again, if you want to prevent all this from happening again, of a tyrannical guy like Napoleon that I might have originally supported, but then he made fun of me in front of a bunch of people, like from actually rising to power, we should probably do the following things, right? And Charles Talleyrand, who represents them there, pitches the ideas of boundaries, right? He's like, first of all, don't go back to 1789, which are the boundaries that included what is now modern-day Belgium and some other areas as well. Go to 1792, which is actually a little bit larger than the 1789 borders, and actually included some other areas like that is now known as Alsace-Lorraine, right? Like, so we'll talk about Alsace-Lorraine a lot later on, right? Also, he pitches the idea as well of no war reparations. He's like, there is no way France can pay for all the damage caused by Napoleon. France can't pay to rebuild Russia. France can't pay to rebuild the entireties of areas that Napoleon destroyed. So there's just no way we can do it, so don't make us. And they decided, okay, we agree on that. And this is the biggest thing Talleyrand gave him. He's like, I know we had a revolution, that we ended up with a republic, and we had a king, and we had a constituent assembly and a national assembly and the rise of a legislative body. But he's like, but we must restore the monarchy. So they literally bring the Bourbon dynasty back. And they actually bring in Louis XVI's brother. And they call him Louis XVIII. Now, some of y'all are like, wait a minute, where'd the 17th go, right? Well, the 17th was Louis XVI's son, right? And he was only alive for a little while. He didn't actually meet or see his way through the entirety of the revolution, and he ended up dying, right? So the thing about it is Louis XVI's brother becomes Louis XVIII, right? And the goal of this whole Congress of Vienna is to prevent any other revolution. And they believe that with these provisions, and then also the reinforcing of the monarchies in places like Prussia, Russia, and Austria, they will prevent another revolution from ever happening, and they will stem the tide of the spread of these Enlightenment ideas, right? What they don't realize is that ideas are a lot like a virus, right? There is no stopping them. You're done, y'all. You're done. All these absolute monarchies need to count their days because they ain't got much longer left because they are about to die. Now, the only way that they were able to achieve some of these provisions, though, as well, is by increasing the size of a couple of other countries, right? Particularly the Netherlands, which we don't really care about the Dutch right now at this point, right? After I just got off the phone with a couple of Dutch hotels, which sounds really offensive. We care more about this other group named Prussia, right? Prussia was given more land, more area, and they actually grew in size, right? And they were also, remember, the Prussians are known for their militarism, right? So if we make them a little bit bigger, maybe it'll intimidate France into staying back a little bit. And by increasing their size and actually bordering them directly on the side of France, they could actually maybe prevent another large-scale French invasion if it ever happens again, right? Now, the other thing about it is we need to understand that all of these things were achieved by one guy, right? There's a dude that is representing Austria at this meeting who's going to become very important in the next unit, right? Not so much this one, but in the next one, right? And you just really need to know his name. And his name is Prince Clemens von Metternich, right? And he is going to usher in this period of time known as the Age of Metternich from 1815 to 1848, which we'll talk about in the next unit, but you just need to keep him in the back of your mind, right? And this guy named Prince Clemens von Metternich is going to represent Austria, and he is going to work with Talleyrand to create this whole Concert of Europe concept, right? And we're going to pause right there, though, because we're going to talk about one more thing in class, and y'all, I can't believe I'm saying this, we're going to have a whole day to review at the end of the week to get ready for y'all's next test, okay? But I'll see y'all then.